Welcome back. Indian cities will generate 70% of net new jobs created by 2030, produce around 70% of India's GDP, and drive a near fourfold increase in per capita income across the nation. India is also going to overtake China when it comes to urbanization. But today on Urban Reality, we're asking at what cost when our government authorities and policy makers can't get something as basic as the air we breathe to stay clean and healthy. And this is becoming worrying me. The entire growth is becoming worrying. The urbanization is becoming worrying. Manjali, I'm going to come to you and ask you this very basic question. This seems to be a complete political and governance failure. So what can the citizens do? Is there anything at all that citizens can take control of rather than being on Twitter or on WhatsApp and just being armchair activists?
Okay, so we have to inconvenience ourselves. The metro is always chock-a-block. Mm-hmm. We don't have extra carriages in there. Plus, we don't have end-to-end. So even if I was to take a metro with my kids to school, I can't actually get to the school without taking a, let's say, a scooter, which is not electric. So I'm right. also contributing. In fact, I remember last time when there was odd-even, you had to drive your car, and my car is a hybrid, which fortunately I was allowed to drive. But my other friends who had petrol cars had to rent taxis that were diesel. So that didn't even make sense. So the things we can do, you know, some of the rules just, it feels like people are just making rules in the government without actually thinking about it. Now, as per urban emissions, 50% of our PM2.5 is solely because of transport and trash burning. This is urbanemissions.info, and Dr. Sarath Gurukhande is a leading environmental scientist. So if these are the two things, what we really need to figure out is our transport. Now, nobody here has talked about the quality of diesel that India uses. Other than, I think, 26 cities that are on Bharat 4, the rest of India is in Bharat 3. That is very high sulfur content. So there was a public interest litigation at the Supreme Court where they said that we could go, that we would have to have Bharat 6 in 2020. And recently, I believe in the newspapers, it's next year.
Absolutely.
But the thing is, we've it's
advanced
been so
it,
long, at
but
least
it's a
people should be
reaction.
Given a choice.
It seems to be a knee-jerk reaction, Vivek Chattopadhyay, the government's decision to just, you know, bring forward the Bharat norms. I don't you think it's just a knee-jerk reaction? In fact, now all the auto companies are saying, what's going on? How can we change all our production norms so quickly to meet new environment standards?
Definitely, these decisions, the BS4 came in Delhi and other cities, in mega cities, in 2010. Thereafter, government took a lot of time to take a decision on next stage of the emission standards. And only in 2016, they took the decision that India will meet the next level of emission standards by 2020. And now they have done a good thing that Delhi will have the BS6, but what about other cities? And it's a major issue because vehicular population across the cities, and especially in mega cities, is growing leaps and bounds. So I think the emission standards have to be tightened, but at the same time, we have to look at the on-road vehicles, which are very polluting, and you can spot, and nobody has faith on the on-road emission checks conducted by PUC centers. Those are pollution under control centers. So our on-road vigilance and emission checking system has to improve. We have to weed out the gross polluting vehicles from the roads, and best
well,
way is to upgrade
in Delhi,
our
they actually
centers.
Allowed 60,000 trucks to come in just because one of the orders expired at 11 p.m. at night. This who's going to check vehicles? I mean, what we are the conversation seemed to be
trucks.
Go ahead.
The problem is the infrastructure needed to check the vehicles have not been upgraded or not up to the mark across the country. Like, we have conducted an audit of PUC centers in Delhi, and we have found that even in Delhi, few centers were passing the vehicles which were supposed to be filled. But in the NCR cities, the PUC infrastructure is totally lacking. They are using false or fake softwares. They are passing with corruption. So I think this is the story across cities.
You talked about the PUC system. I read a wonderful article that now technology by Nandan Nilekani, and I'm going to come to you, Sridhar Pabishetty. I mean, you are talking to us from the tech capital, where he says that every vehicle in India can be actually armed with a simple technology-oriented system. I'm forgetting what that exact name is, where you can... They don't have to stop at tolls to pay the toll. The technology links every car to a single account. You can check the vehicular emissions from that car. Technology makes it possible, but there is absolutely no will even to adopt low-hanging technology solutions when it comes to air pollution.
I completely agree, Manisha. I think what we have to realize is that today in the city of Bengaluru, there are 2.5 lakh cars that are visible on a mobile app through just two private car transport companies. Unfortunately, instead of spending 70 crores, we can't see 6,000 government-run buses on our mobile phones. Hmm. If only we take the efficiency and new technology and say, public transport can be efficient, can also be cost-effective, and if that is internalized by government, they can outcompete the cars and any other private modes of transport any day.
And I interrupted you, Sridhar, but Karnataka state-run transport corporation is actually a sterling example of having a public transport system and also which can also be profitable, isn't it? So it can be replicated across the
country. Absolutely. Absolutely, but they still are missing the goal of outcompeting the private modes of transport. Hmm. Because today I can't have a guarantee of what time I'll reach office if I were to take a public transport system. The last mile connectivity is very important, because even though I can get into metro and out of metro, and metro ride is fast, but coming from home or office to metro becomes a problem. And that's where all our public transport system being available and traceable on mobile phones will bring in the huge shift of people onto the public transport system. Mm-hmm. I want to add a second thing, answering your previous question of saying that what can be done at a ward level and at a local governance level. It's important for us to know what we have lost in the city of Bengaluru, and this is a lesson for across all cities. The concretization of our green spaces, the encroachment of our lakes, has completely deteriorated our ability to absorb pollutants. We should understand, while reducing the putting of pollutants into the environment is one important aspect, second is increasing the absorption capacity of carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, etc., is also rapidly diminishing. Hmm. So the green cover, the lakes, and all of these are deteriorating at a very, very fast pace,
right,
in our race to be on a high GDP curve.
I think, Sridhar, you said it, but let me also
curve.
Get our gentleman here from Mumbai, who's also facing a similar problem. I mean, open green spaces in Mumbai haven't been there for the longest time, sir. What you're getting saved by is the sea breeze, and therefore the air quality here still remains moderate and not poor. Is that something that environmentalists such as you are conscious of?
Absolutely. In fact, we have to keep going to court to protect our open spaces.
Constantly
we have to file a public interest litigation,
right?
To protect Sanjay Gandhi National Park. We have to go to court to protect our mangroves. Hmm. We'll have to go to court to protect our salt pans, and so on and so forth. The government just does not seem to be interested in protecting the environment. And to come back to the issue of vehicular pollution, I must say the only solution to vehicular pollution is to have good public transport.
You can't keep subsidizing private transport.
You can't subsidize flyovers. You can't subsidize sea links. You have to, in fact, increase the public transportation, make it comfortable, make it usable, hmm, and user-friendly. That's the only way you're going to solve the vehicular pollution problem.
I think a common thread in this conversation has been public transport. If you do not get your public transportation system right, you cannot even begin to have a conversation around controlling or keeping your air clean or controlling your air pollution. Now, this is something which every city, how is it not possible to get public transportation systems right when you're talking about 100 smart cities? That is the big question. And if all state governments and, of course, the center doesn't wake up to it, I think we are in serious trouble. Debi Goenka, thank you very much for joining me. Vivek Chattopadhyay, always a pleasure to have CSU View. Manjali Khosla, I believe that your advocacy group is making as much noise as possible. Sridhar Pabishetty, thanks so much. Well, it's now a fact that air pollution is soon turning into a national pandemic. If we do not wake up now, no high growth momentum or demographic dividend will be worth it. Thank you so much for joining me. I'll be back with you same time next week.